E ilustrísimas autoridades, señoras y señores, como presidente de Nueva Economía Forum, tengo el placer de darles de nuevo la bienvenida al Forum Europa que organizamos con la colaboración de Red Eléctrica de España, ASISA y BT. Hoy tenemos el honor de recibir como ponente de esta tribuna a la Comisaria Europea de Mercado Interior, Industria, Emprendimiento y Pymes, la señora Elisabetta Bienkowska, a la que va a presentar nuestro ministro de Industria, Energía y Turismo, don José Manuel Soria. Querido ministro, la tribuna es suya.
Señora comisaria de Mercado Interior e Industria, señor secretario de Estado para la Unión Europea, señor director general de Mercado Interior e Industria, presidente de la Comisión Nacional de Mercado y Competencia, señor embajador de Polonia en España, distinguidas autoridades, señoras y señores. Constituye un honor y una satisfacción poder presentarle a todos ustedes hoy a nuestra conferenciante esta mañana, la señora Elisabetta Bienkowska, que desde el pasado mes de noviembre es la nueva comisaria responsable de Mercado Interior, de Industria, de Emprendimiento y Pequeña y Mediana Empresa. Por tanto, las competencias de la comisaria Bienkowska aglutinan lo que durante el pasado mandato venía recogido dentro de dos comisarías distintas en la Unión Europea, la de Mercado Interior y la de Industria y Emprendimiento. Si bien es verdad que en las competencias que tiene en la actualidad y en aquello que respecta al mercado interior, lo único que queda excluido del ámbito de su competencia son los servicios financieros. Por tanto, estamos ante una comisaría que tiene unas competencias que son fundamentales para la Unión Europea, pero que lo son desde luego también para España. La comisaria de Mercado Interior e Industria tiene una larga y dilatada experiencia política en su país natal, en Polonia. Ha sido ministra de Política Regional con responsabilidades también en materia de infraestructuras, llevando todo lo que tiene que ver con transporte y con vivienda, y ha sido también viceprimer ministra del Gobierno de Polonia bajo el mandato del primer ministro Donald Tusk. Antes de llegar a la comisaría de la Unión Europea, tuvo mucho que ver con la gestión eficaz de todo lo que han sido los fondos europeos destinados a Polonia durante los últimos años. Ha sido la responsable directa de una eficaz gestión de aproximadamente unos 68.000 millones de euros que han sido gestionados en términos de fondos comunitarios en su país y que han propiciado una mejora en la actividad económica, un impulso del crecimiento y también del empleo. Llega a la Comisión Europea en un momento que es crucial para Europa, una cuestión que siempre se dice, pero en estos momentos probablemente sea más cierto que nunca. La Unión Europea, que tiene una moneda común desde el año 2000, que funciona bien, que está en su paridad normal de acuerdo a lo que tiene que ser como impulso de las exportaciones y de la competitividad, que da estabilidad monetaria a la Unión Europea, sin embargo, todavía no hemos sido capaces de articular una verdadera unión económica. Y la unión económica significa muchas cosas. Significa disponer de una unión bancaria, también tener un mercado único de la energía. Supone tener un mercado único digital y esas cuestiones todavía no han sido alcanzadas en toda su plenitud. En la tarde de ayer teníamos una reunión bilateral, la comisaria Bienkowska y yo mismo en el Ministerio de Industria, Energía y Turismo, y abordábamos cuáles eran los retos que se planteaba a lo largo de su mandato en la Unión Europea. Y uno que aparece en el frontispicio de esa política es adoptar medidas concretas para impulsar la reindustrialización de Europa. En Europa, a lo largo de los últimos años, ha ido cayendo paulatinamente el peso de la industria en el conjunto del Producto Interior Bruto Europeo. Algunas de las causas que explican esa caída, lógicamente, están muy vinculadas a determinadas políticas y medidas que hemos adoptado dentro de Europa. No se trata de renunciar, por ejemplo, a seguir liderando en el mundo, por parte de la Unión Europea, la lucha contra el cambio climático. Ese es un reto que Europa ha asumido y debe seguir asumiendo. Pero también es verdad que esa lucha y, por tanto, las medidas que esa lucha trae consigo han de ser compatibles también con esa reindustrialización y, por tanto, con no exigir a las compañías industriales europeas extracostes en los cuales no están incurriendo nuestros principales competidores a nivel mundial, Estados Unidos y fundamentalmente algunas economías asiáticas, como es el caso de la China. Finalmente, también abordamos ayer una de las cuestiones para nosotros sumamente importantes y que también entra dentro de la competencia de la comisaria, que es todo lo que tiene que ver con el sector turístico. Acabamos de cerrar el año 2014 como el mejor año de la evolución del sector turístico en España. Han llegado a España a lo largo del año 2014 65 millones de turistas. En la mañana de hoy el presidente del Gobierno dará a conocer cuáles han sido las cifras de gasto total correspondientes a ese ejercicio. Hemos aumentado el gasto total y tenemos una buena posición en cuanto al gasto diario y el gasto medio realizado por los turistas. Ha sido una historia de éxito la del turismo en España a lo largo de los últimos 50 años, pero el que lo haya sido no significa que tengamos ningún tipo de garantía para que en el futuro lo sigamos haciendo. Para seguir siendo líderes a nivel mundial en turismo, necesitamos adaptarnos a los cambios que se producen en el mundo, en la economía y particularmente en el sector turístico. Y uno de los mayores retos que tenemos en esta materia es prestar mucha atención a la hiperconectividad y a la creciente conectividad digital que se da en la economía mundial y también en la economía española. El turista es cada vez un turista más digital. El turista se informa cada vez más a través de un teléfono inteligente o de una tableta. Y para ello, los países que aspiren a liderar en turismo en el mundo también debemos estar preparados en las infraestructuras digitales necesarias para que el turista pueda también acceder a todos esos servicios que tanto están demandando. Y tener buenas infraestructuras en materia digital significa hacer inversiones en materia de infraestructura. Y para ello necesitamos tener operadores de gran tamaño. Necesitamos consolidar el sector de las telecomunicaciones en España y también en Europa. Esta también es una parte importante, la consecución del mercado único digital por parte de la comisaria Biekowska. Commissioner, the floor is yours.
Okay. May I feel safe with this? It's okay? I will not fall down? Hopefully not. Minister, President of the New Economy Forum, honorable guests, ladies and gentlemen. First, excuse me for my voice. It's not a normal one. It is exceptionally for Spain. I prepared it. So. And really, it's my pleasure. It's a pleasure for me to be here with you today. The next 6 months or this year will be really crucial also for myself to work with the real economy and the people of real economy as you are. We are preparing in my DG a single market strategy for the last quarter of this year and industrial roadmap for June. And that's why meeting the stakeholders and meeting industry people and entrepreneurs is really crucial for me. That's why I'm grateful for the opportunity to set out how the Commission intends to support economic growth. I will support myself with notes and then maybe more free conversation with you, some question answers. Here is in Spain, you understand the task that is in front of us, in Europe, in Spain, in each member state. 6 years of brutal recession, and we are still not out of this. There are still 24 million people unemployed in Europe, 50% more than in 2007, 8 million people more. And of course, what is the most important and most dangerous, young people with few prospects. We must find a way out. We must generate growth and jobs. This is Europe's today top priority. It is the focus of the new European Commission. We must focus on the basic. We must support the real economy. And this is my portfolio. The new Commission has wasted no time. Within 1 month of taking office, we presented a plan to kickstart Europe, the European Investment Plan, Juncker Plan, as it's called. The plan is about putting the savings and liquidity in Europe to use so that we can generate sustainable growth and jobs. The plan has three pillars, as you also probably know. The first one is a financial instrument to mobilize 315 billion euros for 2015-17. The second pillar is a credible project pipeline. And the third pillar is the one that I'm responsible for. So this is a roadmap to make Europe more attractive to investment. It means the whole economic environment in Europe. The fund works by absorbing investment risk that the private sector is reluctant to take. It will help mobilize surplus liquidity and put it into investment projects. The fund will focus on areas of strategic importance: broadband, energy, transport infrastructure, research, education, SMEs, and mid-caps. The fund has already received more than 2,000 proposals for investment, and this is expected to become operational in mid-15. All the regulations are now in place. They were adopted by the Commission. 75 billion euros will be used to support risk finance for SMEs and mid-caps. The new fund will build on existing programs such as COSME, Horizon 2020. Yes, yesterday we signed, I was one of the person that signed SME initiative in Spain, the first such case in Europe. It was the first agreement in Europe for SME initiative. But this is just a start. I have been asked to play a central role in boosting jobs, growth, investment. My DG, the new DG, that we are now merging out of DG Markt and DG Enterprise, name is GROW, not growth, GROW. So I'm going to work in three concrete areas. First one, of course, boosting the internal market for goods and services, which is not working now properly. The second one, promoting industrial competitiveness. And the third one, unblocking the business environment and supporting SMEs. Let me refer to each of the points. First one, the internal market, as all of us know, is crucial for jobs, for growth, but it is still incomplete. I'm going to act in three areas. First, I'm going to do more to integrate the services market. The services sector plays a central part in our economy. It represents 70% of EU GDP and employment, and it's crucial for industry. In some sectors of industry, 70-80% of their activities are services. But too many barriers still exist, and new ones are being created. The services directive is delivering benefits, but not enough. We need to make it work better, and that means making sure that this is actually being implemented. This would yield 0.5% of EU GDP. This is an extra 50% over what we are delivering. This summer, I will put forward a renewed strategy for services. Part of that will be about reducing time and procedures for companies wishing to establish in another member state. I think that too many companies, and it is quite obvious, too many companies are wasting time, wasting money on unnecessary procedures. This needs to stop. Another part will be about removing obstacles to e-commerce. Only 10% of European consumers buy online cross-border. Too many SMEs do not take part because of the barriers they face cross-border. And we must move forward on e-government. So we need to simplify procedures, put all the information in one place and allow companies to complete procedures online. It can be done. The Spanish government is already making progress on all this. This is a very good example. Second point, in internal market, we need to use public procurement to generate growth. Public procurement represents 19% of European GDP. It can be a very powerful tool to boost growth and to promote research and investment. And a successful public procurement policy will lead to budgetary savings. In 2014, the Commission reformed public procurement across Europe. The Commission simplified procedures. We need to make it easier for SMEs to access the market. And we move to speed up the introduction of e-procurement, which are very helpful for SMEs. This is only a first step. The rules must be transported across Europe. And we must ensure that they are actually work on the ground. E-procurement will be crucial. It offers major benefits, as I mentioned. It is cheaper, faster, more transparent, and more accessible, and also help SMEs. We need a more integrated single market in public purchases. I will push member states to remove non-transparent practices and unfair treatment of non-national businesses. Finally, we need to make progress internationally. We must ensure that China enters the government procurement agreement. We must get an ambitious agreement within the TTIP, Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, and we must be ambitious in the free trade agreement with Japan. On top of all this work on services and procurement, we'll push hard on effective enforcement rules. I'm repeating this, but again I will repeat. I will show zero tolerance. The second priority, I wanted to say the most important one, but all of them are very important. Industry. Three. Industry. Everybody repeating reindustrialization, industrial competitiveness. But we have to make it work. The second, manufacturing is of major importance. The figures in this case are also very clear. Industry accounts of 80% of private sector research and innovation in the EU. It generates 75% of Europe's export. We want industry's share of EU GDP to go up, rising from 15% now to 20% in 2020. If we do this, we will keep and create high-value jobs. We will raise productivity. And in the next months, we will deliver an action plan to do this, which will be based on four areas. First, we will act to give industry better access to markets in the EU and beyond. We rely heavily on international markets. We have recently signed free trade agreements with Colombia, Peru, and Canada. And we will continue to open up markets beyond Europe. Our companies need a fair chance to compete globally. If the TTIP is agreed, and this year is also very crucial for this, if not now, then maybe it will be prolongated. I don't know for how long. It could generate an additional 120 billion for the EU on manufacturing alone. The second point for industry, we need to deliver affordable access to resources. It is also repeating question. Finance, energy, raw material, skills. Europe has some of the highest energy prices in the world. This pushes up costs, particularly for energy-intensive production, so we need to address this. Greater energy efficiency is, of course, crucial. We need to push the energy union. We need to promote vocational training. We need, again, to improve access to finance. The European Investment Bank plan will play a key role, as I mentioned before at the very beginning, but also existing programs such as Horizon 2020, structural funds, COSME, SME initiative will inject additionally 100 billion euros to support growth. The third thing is innovation and modernization. If Europe cannot simply compete on price, then we must create and produce more advanced goods and services, or we must learn to make them more efficiently. We must develop key technologies such as digital, advanced manufacturing, biotech and nanotechnology. We have to modernize our industry. We must make it ready for tomorrow's challenges. And fourth point, industry needs a favorable business environment. Companies need better regulation. Simplification is at the top of the Commission agenda. We have made such progress with the REFIT program, but we need to do more. This year, for this Commission working program, for this year, we have taken 80 legislative proposals off the table. Just to mention, in my case, two of them. In chemicals, we have reduced the fees and are working on improving the implementation of REACH. In construction, we are looking at the current legislation, whether it fits for a purpose. Modern industrial policy is cross-cutting. Industrial competitiveness needs to be integrated across every policy area. Environment, trade, competition, innovation, other policies have a direct impact on this. What we do with one hand must help with another. And the construction of the new commission is working like this. We are working in a project manner, not in silos, you know, every commissioner separately from the other. And my third priority, supporting SMEs and entrepreneurs. Of course, everyone knows that SMEs are the backbone of our economy. I think we can help in a few ways. First, we can help them to access finance needed to develop their business. Second, we can reduce the administrative burden on them. We can create electronic one-stop shops. We can shorten startup and licensing procedures. We can help transfers of businesses. We can give honest entrepreneurs a second chance. We can help SME internationally. This year, we relaunched the Enterprise Europe Network, 600 organizations in Europe and worldwide to help SMEs expand into other markets. And finally, we can revive the culture of entrepreneurship. That means better education and training. That means reaching out to specific group where we see unused potential. But beyond all of this, we can give SMEs single market. This is crucial for them. The biggest assets of Europe is 500 million market. This is our asset. And everyone government must understand that it's not separate market of 4 million, 500,000. It's 500 million people, and we can compete with this. As you can see, my work agenda is pretty charged for the next 5 years, but really this year is very important. We will prepare those two documents, or even three, which I mentioned, industrial roadmap, plan for services, and finally, in fourth quarter of this year, single market strategy. I am glad to be sharing this table with Minister Soria, whose agenda for the strengthening of the industrial sector in Spain we discussed yesterday. And I am really glad to see that Spain and Europe's industrial policy are fully aligned. And as I said, 2015 is crucial, both for Spain and for Europe and for everyone member state. We are still in a very difficult times. There are signs of recovery, but we need to do all we can to put people back into job. This is our most important and top task. We need a pragmatic, modern, and focused policy that delivers results. We need a modern public administration that helps citizens and businesses. We need to simplify it, not complicate. My motto, I use it also in the hearing, will be accelerate and integrate. Accelerate the implementation of concrete action, I want to stress this, to support a competitive European economy, and better integrate competitiveness in all policy areas in EU level. Thank you very much.
Gracias, comisaria. Muchas gracias, ministro Soria. Comenzamos con las preguntas. Ayer el Gobierno de España, la Comisión Europea y el Banco Europeo de Inversiones firmaron un pionero acuerdo para la financiación de pymes. Luis del Pozo le pregunta si podría explicarnos algo sobre cómo funcionarán estos préstamos, cómo podrán beneficiarse las pymes de menos de 250 empleados y los autónomos, cuyas organizaciones más representativas están hoy representadas aquí. ¿Es demasiado optimista nuestro Ministerio de Hacienda que prevé que con esta línea de financiación se podrán crear 64.000 nuevos empleos y mantener otros 120.000 ya existentes?
All of the instruments that we are promoting now or we are proposing now, they must have this leverage effect. So we are guaranteeing the money that will attract private ones for the projects which probably without these guarantees and without the European part of the financing will not ever be financed. So. Our estimation for both SME initiative and our estimation for investment fund are rather moderate as we are counting this. We think if, as far as the European Investment Fund is investment fund Juncker plan is concerned, it will work in the framework of European Investment Bank and then it will go through banks to directly to SMEs and to businesses and to private sector.
Muchas gracias. Alicia Rodríguez le pregunta, señora comisaria, su compañero, el vicepresidente de la Comisión Europea, señor Katainen, está realizando un roadshow para convencer a empresas globales a que inviertan en proyectos. Ahora. Su compañero, el vicepresidente de la Comisión Europea, señor Katainen, está realizando un roadshow para convencer a empresas globales a que inviertan en proyectos viables del llamado Plan Juncker, con el fin de reactivar la economía y la competitividad, volver a crecer y crear empleo. Alicia Rodríguez le pregunta qué impresión tiene usted sobre la acogida de los grandes inversores a este plan. Si no le parece excesivo el porcentaje de colaboración privada que se ha previsto, ¿qué incentivos fiscales o de otro tipo tendrán esas empresas privadas que participen en el plan Juncker? ¿Podría adelantarnos? Le sigue preguntando qué empresas o consorcios se han interesado inicialmente. ¿Se podrán beneficiar de las últimas medidas acordadas por el Banco Central Europeo? Y también le pregunta en qué va a consistir la garantía europea.
What we want to do, as I mentioned before, is take the money which we see that are in the banks and that are in the private companies and assure that this money will work on projects which are really the most important for the EU. So, as I also mentioned before, our calculation for this leverage effect were quite moderate. We think and we see a lot of projects, now 2,000 of them that were sent by the member states, but frankly speaking, I might say that this is my biggest concern. You know, every member state saying that they have very important projects and very attractive for the private financing, but we have to see and we have really to look into the project to be sure whether they are really attractive and whether they will create as many jobs as we are member states are calculating now. So the work of European Investment Bank will go in this way and it will be concluded finished by June. So in June we want to have the instrument in place working through banks in each member state to give the guarantees and the money, this part of the European money to the private sector.
Seguimos. César Ortega le pregunta cómo van las negociaciones para el acuerdo de libre comercio con Estados Unidos. ¿Con qué escollos se están tropezando? ¿Qué sectores están resultando más sensibles?
Of course, the leading commissioner here is Commissioner for Trade, Madam Malmström. But we are very crucial and very important part of the negotiations. As I said, this is the year because we have election later in the United States. So if not this year, probably it will be the deadline will be unknown. So we started very intensively the discussion. The most sensitive sector are cosmetics, chemicals, automotive. And these are our sector, I mean, in my portfolio. What is the most important for me personally and for my DG is to have the same rights on both sides of the ocean. I mean, it cannot go like this, that we are completely open and European market is open and US market is closed. So the mutual recognition is really the most important, and this will be the task for us. Cosmetics, chemicals, automotive are on our side the most sensitive ones.
Usted va a participar este mediodía con el presidente del gobierno, don Mariano Rajoy, en un foro sobre turismo preámbulo de Fitur. ¿Qué va a hacer Europa para aumentar el negocio turístico, para ser más atractiva y hacer una oferta más consistente en su conjunto, no obstante el liderazgo claro de España? Constantino III le pregunta si tienen ustedes alarma sobre el impacto negativo que podría tener para el turismo europeo la amenaza yihadista.
I did not mention tourism sector in my speech, because I will have a whole speech on this during the event later on. But it's of course for Spain and for several other countries, the tourism is the most crucial sector, or one of the most crucial sector of the economy. So, and of course the most competences on the tourism are on the national level. But definitely, as it is very important part of the economy and very important part of the industry, we will have tourism mention anyway, we'll need your help also in, you know, in what way European Union can help and can really work with the tourism sector. We will have tourism sector included in both in the industrial roadmap and the single market strategy, definitely. This is our goal. Of course, as I said, we don't want to add any new regulations on the Commission, on the European side. That's why the most competences that are now on the national level will be there, and we will not there is no need to add any new barriers and a new regulation on the European level. But definitely, as it is one of the most important sector and mostly connected with SMEs, it is also it has the same problem and as the other part of the industry and another part of the economy. So it will be. It will have its point in our plans. Of course, we are working. We are discussing it yesterday on visas problem, which is from the third countries, which is really very important. It is also very touches the tourism sector. Europe is still one of the biggest and one of the most important part of the global tourism sector, but it's losing for the some cheaper directions. So we have just to discuss with the member state what are the best way, also connected with the last part of your question. I mean about the terror attacks. Of course, everywhere in Egypt also, as such attacks happen, there were some longer or in short and long period, there were some influences on the sector. We will work on this.
Es evidente que usted es una comisaria con mucho poder. Una de sus muchas e importantes competencias tiene que ver con el Sistema Europeo de Satélites de Comunicaciones, impulsado por la recordada comisaria española, doña Loyola de Palacio. Están aquí con nosotros sus hermanas. Jacinto Castro le pregunta si está estudiando introducir medidas, activar algún proyecto que ponga aún más en valor estas infraestructuras.
This is when you said I'm a very powerful commissioner. I'm still, you know, we'll see next month and years. But really, space is something very concrete in this portfolio. We have two programs, Galileo and Copernicus, and this is one point of our competitiveness. We are still a lot years behind US. And the China is catching up very quickly. So we have to work on European space policy. And really, this is the only one point in the Commission working plan in my agenda added to the Commission working plan. I mean, on dissemination of satellite data. I think this is a very small point, but very crucial for European industry. Satellite data are crucial for transport, for real estate, for, you know, normal life and real economy. And that's why this is, we will work on the space policy. We want to launch probably in March the next satellite, and we will work on the Copernicus also, because this is part of our competitiveness. I'm quite sure about it.
Maria José Camino.
And quite a lot of money, by the way.
María José Camino, de Antena 3, dice, como comisaria europea, ¿cómo van a ser las relaciones con el nuevo gobierno griego? ¿Es posible una quita de la deuda griega? ¿Ve un futuro esperanzador para Grecia? Más preguntas sobre este tema. Cristóbal Cortés dice, ¿qué valoración hace del resultado de las elecciones en Grecia? ¿Conceder al gobierno griego, un tratamiento especial no enfadaría a países como España, Portugal, Irlanda, que han hecho esfuerzos enormes con costes sociales sin precedentes?
I can only say this. The democracy is as it is. The majority of voters chose this party. As far as I know, President Juncker invited the new Prime Minister of Greece to Brussels. But of course, some commitments between the European Commission and Greece were made. And we think that those commitments will be kept now in the next months and years. And it's also because of the situation in Italy and Spain that your efforts were really visible, and European Commission saw it and appreciated it. So that's why this is the only answer we can give now for this.
Carmelo Rodríguez dice, usted se ha reunido recientemente con el consejero delegado de Uber, la empresa de servicios de taxi a través de particulares, que ha encontrado problemas en España, Francia, Alemania o Bélgica, donde sus operaciones han sido total o parcialmente prohibidas por no ajustarse a la legislación de cada país. Le pregunta si van a ustedes a adoptar medidas, qué tipo de medidas, en tanto que responsable de mercado interior.
We have to work very carefully on this case, because what is important, you mentioned Spain, Belgium and France, but there are other member states which are welcoming such services. And this is the problem, that we do not have single market in this. And the companies are facing different rules and different regulations in different member states. So I do not have the answer for this for now. But of course, the Uber is complaining on French law to the European Commission for the time being. And we will work very closely on this, because this is one very difficult point and difficult part of the single market. It cannot go, you know, work like this. What is the difference between European Union? Of course, there are differences, a lot of them, but between United States and European Union as far as the single market is concerned. When things is invented and you know, put to the market in one place, in one state, the whole European, the whole USA is open to this. In European Union, it's quite the contrary. We have the services directive. We have, in theory, single market for goods and services, but it's not working in practice. So I don't know what will be the Commission answer this on this side, but definitely it must be single market. That's it. There must be one answer to the UBER's questions, yes or no.
Claudio Valencia dice, ¿qué iniciativa se está preparando en cuanto a los mercados públicos europeos, la contratación de obras y servicios de las administraciones para evitar la discriminación, lograr que los concursos tengan un ámbito realmente europeo y exista una tolerancia mayor sin necesidad de nuevas directivas, puesto que son suficientes las que ya existen? Miguel Ángel Rivero dice, entre las prioridades de Europa está ayudar a las pymes en su desarrollo integral. Sin embargo, en España es muy difícil que las pymes podamos acceder a concursos públicos debido a la a las dificultades para acceder a ellos. ¿Hay alguna directiva que obligue a los gobiernos y al resto de las administraciones públicas a licitar contratos de servicios, obras, etcétera, que puedan ser accesibles a las pymes?
As I mentioned in my speech, the new regulation were just established last year. So I really don't want to add a new one. We have to check why the cross-border public procurement are not working. This is the first thing first. To check how the new regulations are working in a real life. But what is very important for SMEs, we are quite sure, and it was checked, that e-public procurement really allowing much more SMEs to play on the public market, public procurement market. Portugal, which really were really they established e-procurement in the most wide way in Europe, they have much more SMEs using the public procurement and really, you know, acting in on a public procurement field. So this is something what we have to do also this year. That's why I said this year is very important, because we have to check what is working, what is not working. Not adding new regulations because we don't know anything, and I'm quite sure that civil servant, European ones and national ones, they don't know everything. You know what's going on. So no new regulations, just checking the old one, maybe cutting some of them, as we did for the Commission working program for this year, and then, but of course, promoting the e-public procurement, which we think is very crucial for SMEs mostly, and for cross-border public procurement also.
El presidente de la Confederación Empresarial Independiente de Madrid, de la COE, don Juan Pablo Lázaro, le pregunta, ¿un problema para las pymes de Europa es la competencia desleal de empresas públicas competidoras con sectores, en sectores privados o privatizables como el postal, el transporte de viajeros, etcétera? ¿Cuáles son sus planes para acabar con esto, señora comisaria?
That private companies are facing unfair competition from the public companies, yes?
This Eso es lo que question. Señala el presidente de CEIM. Y asiente el secretario general de la COE.
Yeah. Yeah. In every case, because companies they have with the public shares are the same actors on the market as private ones. We have to check whether really there are some obstacles, whether really there are some barriers. We will work very closely on the mail and on package delivery and in the mail sector, I mean the post offices. So this is number one. I have no any signals from the public transportation so far. Maybe it's too short because it's 3 months, but I have no such signal from the public transport. From the mail sector, yes, and we are working on this.
Okay. José Miguel Guerrero le pregunta si tiene previsto usted poner en marcha desde su comisaría alguna medida o mecanismo concreto que garantice que la inyección de dinero que hará el Banco Central Europeo a través de la compra de deuda llegará de verdad a la economía real, especialmente a las pymes y a la industria.
This is our main goal. This is not a money for European Central Bank. This is not a money for European Investment Bank. This must be a money for private sector, and of course, in private sector, SMEs are the biggest part of this. So I know that also my experience, previous experience from my previous life with the you know, longitude of the working on the and the really the process. The processes in the Commission are not very satisfactory, but this is our goal. I cannot assure you that it will go like this, but this is the goal of the Juncker plan, and this is the goal of the other instrument that we are having. We need them to reach SMEs and to reach really the bottom of the real life. I'm not using real economy, real life. So.
Fernando Borrachero,
but I think that we do not have a second choice. This is something for the next 5 years. If not, then the whole idea of European Union, it will not be ruined, but it will very much destroyed. So this, you know, this Commission does not has any other choice. It has to really reach the citizens and reach SMEs, reach the real life and real economy. We do not have other choice.
Fernando Borrachero, de la Cámara de Comercio Hispano-Polaca, dice: en los próximos meses, Polonia va a poner en marcha más de 82.000 millones de fondos de la Unión Europea. ¿En qué sectores considera que puede haber una mayor colaboración entre empresas polacas y españolas, en su experiencia de viceprimer ministra?
I cannot tell you what will be those points of collaboration, but I can tell you what will be the main channels, will be the main channels of the money in Poland. Really, as Spain many years ago, we are now a biggest beneficiary of the European policy. We'll have more than 100 billion. I'm European now. So Poland, the country I know the best. The country I know the best will get more than 100 billion euro for different, you know, projects. But what was the really most important for Polish government? It was really reshaping and changing the channel of the money. So it will, of course, there will be a part, infrastructural part, but what will be the most important is innovation, research and development, and this connection between Polish universities and the market. This is a crucial one because ideas that can be sold to the market are the most crucial and the most expensive in the modern world. So in Poland, this you know, connection is not working, maybe not at all, but it's not working. Our universities are inventing things that companies don't will to sell to the market. I know that this is a problem in some other countries, but in Poland it's really, and we have to do the best with this money to really jump to the other level of development. So these are environment, research, development, SMEs of course, and enterprises, because we will have four times money more than before for the companies, and of course also foreign companies like daughter companies in Poland, their daughter companies can use the money as the Polish one. So and we had a lot of such experience previously. We have in each Polish regions, Polish government selected such smart specialties, and they will be financed. So I don't know whether the point of contact between Polish and Spanish economy is on this, but this I can tell you that the money, there is a lot of money. Of course, the money is very difficult, as all of you know, because European money is checked five times before, during, and after. But it's really a kind of challenge and advantage, and
Poland really used the money before very effectively, and it's, you know, we doubled doubled its GDP during the last 10 years, doubled. So it's really something.
Doña Benita Ferrero Waldner, que fuera comisaria europea, dice usted ha mencionado el Tratado de Comercio con Estados Unidos. Creo que sería importante, dice doña Benita, que informe también sobre los acuerdos de los estados de América Latina, que tienen también un acuerdo con la Unión Europea. ¿Qué piensa usted de este tema?
I also was touching upon this just very shortly, but on the other agreement, of course, the TTIP now is the most important, not most important, but the time is right now. We have the support for TTIP from both parties in the United States, and nobody is against, and the time before the election is right. So if not this year, it will be lost for maybe a few other years. But as I mentioned, there are bilateral agreements, and of course there will be summits soon, South America, European Union, where we also will have our interest and we'll work on this again. And we are, again, I will say, the commissioner in charge is Commissioner Malmström, but we as a commission and the DG for industry, we have a lot to do and a lot to think about and a lot to discuss and a lot to negotiate in everyone's international, European Union international agreement.
Señora comisaria, con su permiso, llega una pregunta ceñida a la actualidad, dirigida al señor ministro de Industria, el señor Soria, que está con nosotros. ¿Me permite poder hacérsela?
Of course I don't mind. I'm losing my voice completely and I have another few other meetings. So please take one question.
Muy bien. Una solo. Desde La Sexta le piden al señor ministro valoración sobre la apertura de la causa contra el proyecto Castor relativo a la construcción del depósito subterráneo de gas en la costa mediterránea que produjo temblores en la zona.
Muchas gracias. En primer lugar, quería decir que, como en cualquier tipo de causa judicial o en cualquier tipo de instrucción judicial, todos debemos ser sumamente respetuosos con lo que son las iniciativas de los jueces. Dicho lo cual, quiero decir que este almacenamiento subterráneo es fruto de una autorización administrativa que se otorgó por un Real Decreto del año 2008, en un momento en el que había pues una determinada planificación energética en general y particularmente en lo que tocaba al sector gasista, en virtud de la cual había que impulsar tanto los almacenamientos subterráneos como los oleoductos en España y también las regasificadoras. A lo largo de los años posteriores, digamos que la evolución de la actividad económica y la evolución de la propia demanda de la energía en general y particularmente del gas no ha ido acorde con los objetivos de aquella planificación. Y, por tanto, ahora mismo tenemos una capacidad sobrante importante desde el punto de vista de lo que son esas infraestructuras. En cuanto al almacenamiento de Castor, los pasos que este Gobierno ha seguido desde el principio de la legislatura han sido todos muy claros. En primer lugar, hicimos una revisión a la baja de la retribución superior al 10% que estaba prevista en aquel Real Decreto de autorización del año 2008. En segundo lugar, declaramos por Consejo de Ministros la lesividad de algunas de las cláusulas que estaban incluidas en aquel Real Decreto de autorización del año 2008. En tercer lugar, paramos todo tipo de actividad en la propia planta como consecuencia de esos movimientos sísmicos a los que se ha hecho referencia. Y en cuarto lugar, una vez que el concesionario de la autorización renunció en base al derecho que tenía en ese Real Decreto de autorización, el Gobierno procedió a indemnizar por el valor residual de la inversión, previo a lo cual se hizo un acuerdo con el operador del sistema gasista en España, con Enagás, para que se ocupara del mantenimiento, que no de la explotación, del almacenamiento y de la planta, mientras no haya informes adicionales que declaren de una manera fehaciente que esa instalación puede seguir adelante o bien que no pueda seguir definitivamente.
Señora comisaria, ha finalizado el descanso. Seguimos. Antonio Calzada, de la Cámara de Comercio Hispano-Portuguesa, dice: «Hemos hablado de una agenda más simple para los objetivos europeos en servicios, industria y acceso al mercado. ¿Qué vamos a hacer objetivamente para simplificar y acelerar realmente esa agenda?».
We have to do the thing, three things. So first, to address regulatory barriers, we have to check whether there are any, probably there are any European barriers that are really stopping companies from working and from their activities. Then we have to reduce administrative burden. And to, we have to improve, as I mentioned, the single markets for services for consumer. I think that the best thing that European Commission can do for SMEs, I said it before, is to give them internal market. Because for SMEs, most competences are on the national level. There are taxes, there are some regulations on, you know, on financial regulations, they are on the national level. I was looking for this, maybe not very thoroughly, because we are doing it just right now, but I think the best thing we can do for companies is to give them single, real, proper, working single market. And this is our task for this year and for the next year, of course. And of course, I understand that during the crisis, the member states are closing the market. They you know, propose every kind of protectionist measures, but it cannot go on like this in European Union. If we are one market, one 500 million people market, this is, I'm repeating, we have to use all the opportunities to have this one market and have one single internal market. That's
Una última pregunta. Luis Roca de Togores. No. Estas son las que le he hecho. No, en absoluto. Usted además tiene mucha fuerza para resistir esto y muchas más cosas. Luis Roca de Togores dice: ¿cómo pretende alcanzar la unidad de mercado desde un punto de vista de los impuestos? Y ya finalizamos.
From a tax point of view. I don't want to pass to anybody, but this is a competition of the Commissioner Hill, Jonathan Hill, who is working on the financial union, and these are his obligation and his proposals. But I think because a lot on this field was done before by DG MAG, by Commissioner Barnier during the time of crisis, this issue was really on the top of their priority. Now the services and goods are on the top of our priority. So I don't want to pass this answer to my colleague, but because we are working very closely together. But I think the same way, and I will work, you know, because this is the last time, probably one of the last, that I'm repeating that I will be, you know, the enforcement. I will go for enforcement with the member state. But how to go on with this? No, how to discuss with each member state? And I think that this is my most difficult job. I will have to discuss with each member state the issues of single market. And as we are sitting here, everybody agrees the single market is a value, is something that's very important. But when you start to discuss with everyone, member states, there are a lot of barriers, both for tax, both for financial, single market rules, and for goods and services. And this is, will be really, really, a really tough job for me. And I hope, I'm counting on your support, on Spain's support in this, because the biggest member states are against it. I mean, verbally, they are, of course, for. but in real life, they are not using the single market, both for financial services and for normal like services. They are not using the opportunity the single market gives them. So.
Muchas gracias. En nombre de Red Eléctrica de España, ASISA y BT, don Luis Argüello, secretario general, en esta última va a despedir el acto.
Señora comisaria, me cede en el honor de agradecerle en nombre no solo de los patrocinadores, sino de todos los presentes sus palabras en este acto. Es un privilegio el oír de primera mano a una persona que viene de un país tan lejano, pero tan querido y tan admirado en España, para que nos explique los proyectos de esta comisión en los que confiamos tenga un enorme éxito por la cuenta que nos trae. Muchas gracias.